everyone, welcome, welcome, welcome to Dear Dr. Sunday. I welcome all of you. Thank you for coming and joining us. And I want to ask you all to go ahead and share this link, share the link to this video with your friends, your family members, and everyone on your friend list. Invite them so we can all join into the conversation tonight and discuss one more message Dr. Sunday has gotten. Actually, we're still on the message we had last time, and we're trying to go through it. Hopefully, we'll do that today. Let's see how far we will get. And so you're all invited to join into a conversation and share your experience. Share if you can see yourself, if there are lessons that you have made as well. And you're also invited to share your own message to Dr. Sunday. If there's something that you want to share with people, maybe not in by calling in or in person, you can also message Dr. Sunday. You can send him an email to pastor@godembassy.org and share your testimony, share your story, share how listening to his teachings have changed your life, and what you're doing differently. What is it that has changed in your life, and how have those teachings impacted you? So share them with us. We would love to hear from you, and then possibly also read out your letter to him. So we'll await as well your input. Welcome, Dr. Sunday.
I guess I should be welcoming you today.
Well,
I'm welcome. Yes, I'm here.
Yes. So we still did not finish this letter.
We are the only ones who know.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
I think it's just in the interest of the people is to just know what people are writing. So mm-hmm. We don't even mention names anyway.
Yeah. So you must have followed us hopefully the last few weeks when we had the last sessions, and we were going through this particular letter or message that was sent to Dr. Sunday. And this person's life has changed a lot, particularly in his relationship with his wife and the way that the motives have changed for him to do some course at home, for instance. We were discussing how he now enjoys or wants to go to clean up in the house and help the wife to relieve her of all the chores in the house that she would normally do. And this is only because he's been listening to Dr. Sunday's teachings, not even on in regards to relationships, but just recent teachings on the church and many others that Dr. Sunday was going through the past few weeks and months. And this time we're going to continue. So we're going to go by the 8 points that he mentioned. So far we have been going through 4, so 50%, half of it, and we're going to continue with the second half now. So I'll just get started, right? Okay, so the 5th point that he's mentioning that has changed in his life. I used to hate reading books, except for my professional books, for professional development. But now, I'm consuming your books like a hot, delicious meal, and listening to your videos when I can't read your books. I'm on my way to becoming an addicted reader, something that was so difficult for me to do before now. So, yeah, what do you say about this, Dr. Sunday?
That he's going to become an addictive reader.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's a good thing, because people have always said that if you want to hide something from a black man, that you should put it in a book. So, thankfully, that people can now be re-energize themselves just by listening to these messages, that their desire to read comes alive.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's a good thing, because then the secrets that are hidden in books will not, these people will not be deprived of the opportunity to learn all the great stuff that are in books that way. So they'll be able to to get the best in life for themselves. Actually, reading is one of the greatest blessings of life. not to read is to deprive oneself. So if this person, just by listening to me and reading my books, wants to become a read addict and reading, and he's almost been addicted to reading, I personally would think that that is probably one of the greatest miracles and blessings that this person has received. The ability to read, the desire to read, and the passion to read. If anybody has it, he has everything. So I will say, you know, congratulations. Big congratulations to this person.
There are also many people who want to read, but they are not really good at it, or they are very slow readers. And looking at the amount of your books, they will think, what should I do? Because it takes me so long to just read one of your books, and then you write so many more and more. I mean, it's just too much to catch up with. So what would you tell a person who's just overwhelmed by all the amount of books that you have? And what should they do, especially if they're a slow reader or they have just have issues reading?
There was a training or a seminar that was part of the HMT that we had. I think that was the last HMT in January. Was it January? Mm-hmm. That is, we had one of my pastors, a Russian pastor, a Ukrainian pastor, a lady pastor, Pastor Victoria. She came to talk about books and how she had worked with me with books. So she actually came up with a strategy on how everybody could read up to, is it 100 books or 200 books in a year? So if these people are interested in learning to read and reading many books, they could actually put that strategy in place and in 3 years finish all my books. Oh, in 2 years.
Wow.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
You need to listen to that seminar.
Yeah.
By Pastor Victoria Melnick.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so guys, if you want to know how to read fast and how to read a lot as soon as possible, Pastor Sunday has just told you a really good secret. Well, you have to go and uncover the secret yourself, because you have to go to Sunday at Elijah Official and on YouTube and find the video on that we had during the last HMT in January. It was on Law and Order. So if you go and search for Pastor Victoria in Dr. Sunday's channel, you will find the video, and then you can go through the teachings that she has shared about how to read about 100 to 200 books in a year. So you may be able to get to catch up fine at the end of the day if you're overwhelmed by all the books that Dr. Sunday is writing.
But you know what is the what do you call it? The paradox of life is that when I only had one or two books in English, and people would ask, "Can we get your books? Can we get your books?" They were even offering to give me money out to translate. For translation of my books, because they heard that I had so many books in Russian. So all the people were coming, okay, let's give you money. Let's translate the books. Please get the books into English. We need your books. We need as many as possible. Please let's get your books. Where are your books in Russian? In English. Let's get them. We are ready to pay for it. Please get the books up. I say, but when there are too many, you will not succeed. By the time I begin to do it in English, you will not even succeed in reading them. They said, no problem, just get them in English. Well, now I got them in English. And what do you think?
People are certainly overwhelmed.
They are now running away.
Yeah.
They are now the ones running away from the same books that they were begging me to get into English. Now I got the books into English, and I can't get them to cope, because they didn't know what was coming their way.
Yeah.
And that's a lesson. Beware of what you are asking for. You might be asking for something too big for you to bite.
Yeah, something that you're not ready for yet.
Well, you know, they just don't know who you are dealing with. As a Pastor Sunday, you need your books in English. I told them, well, are you sure? It's just like when people used to invite me to come preach in their churches. Some of the people I'm showing right now on my live broadcast, they are clips. Some people like Enenshe, Paul Enenshe, who used to invite me and ask me, please come and preach for me. Please come and speak in our church. We have a great church. Please come and speak. I said, no, I will not come and speak in your church. He said, why? No, please. He was coming to visit me in Nigeria when I was in Nigeria. I used to visit Nigeria. He and his wife would come and beg me to come and speak for him. I said, no, I will not. Thank God I didn't. Because I said, so I said, why wouldn't you like to come to speak? I said, you don't know what you're asking for. I said, before I will come to speak in your church, go and listen to 200 of my messages, or 400. And then after you have processed that, then you tell me if I should still come to your church or not. Because I said, if I come to your church, yeah, your church is not ready for it, I'm afraid that church will be scattered at the end of the day by the time I'm through. And so that you don't begin to accuse me that I've come to destroy your church, go and upgrade. Don't let me come. Don't, just leave me alone. And many, many churches like this. Redeemed churches used to invite me to come and speak. I spoke in a few and I said, no, I will not go anymore. Because if I begin to speak and go to speak in these churches, the churches will be dead before the end of the day, I mean, before I'm through. Because the truth that will be coming out will be so overwhelming to people of those churches, because they are not used to hearing this truth. And the eyes of the people will be open. And when people's eyes open, they will run for their lives. Those pastors will not have church anymore. I kept on telling these guys these things, and I think now they understand what I'm talking about. Now I think they understand what I'm talking about.
Wow. Well, I guess this applies to many people on different levels. When it comes to your books, when they read your books and they're just thinking, oh my God, where has this been all the time? Or when just listening to your messages, other people who call in all the time, they're so overwhelmed that often people don't speak to the message itself because they're so overwhelmed about the truth that they're receiving. So I guess we just have to somehow find a way to, I don't know, prepare ourselves, like go back to re-listen and then just renew our minds, renew what we thought we knew or what we've listened to, just study it and try to make it become something more tangible.
Or another thing I could do is just to stop doing any program anymore.
Yeah.
To stop writing any more books and doing any more live broadcasts. Maybe that will help people for cash up.
I don't know. It's really, I think it's a personal decision. And I think with the era that we live in, having social media, somehow it just attracts people and it's just the motivation. Many people don't go to church anymore and they're looking for a substitute. So coming to listen is somehow church for them. So I don't think it will necessarily do good, especially it's because it's truth. People really need that. But I was actually thinking into that direction, thinking what would be if you, for example, took a break of a week or something and just told people, okay, go and re-listen to what I've taught and next week I'm coming back. Maybe there's like something in between that could be found just to promote like self-development in people, because with all the teachings coming in every day, it is overwhelming. And you yourself, you said that you took a long time to prepare those teachings in the first place. So if it took you so long, how long is it going to take us to digest everything? So, yeah, maybe we can discuss this in a bit more in detail at some point.
Well, I'm sure people might be writing their opinion in regards to this. So we'll hear what they have to say. But I think we have tried stopping. The stoppage option has been tried one time. Last year, in January, I stopped, not of my own choice, but because Facebook took us off. So I stopped coming on for 6 months, or no, maybe it was it? Mm-hmm. Above 6 months, five, 6 months. And was not good for people because people didn't were not going to. People just caught up. Were just caught up in other frivolities and in other activities of life, in other vanities of life.
Yeah.
And I discovered that this program was actually keeping them focused and keeping them motivated before and keeping them going. So, but I don't think stopping might be the best option. But for me, I'm not really particular about people making it, being able to catch up or not catch up. That's not the reason why I'm doing what I'm doing. I just need to be able to deliver what God has put in me, so I don't care if anybody gets to listen to it or they don't get to listen to it. I just need to, do what I need to do, and then the history will judge, and the next generation of people, the posterity will be able to have something in their hands. At least if anybody will be looking for answers and solutions in the future, there will be a place to look for it, and there will be something to refer to, rather than just saying, well, no black man has ever done anything of significance. It doesn't just have to be because I'm a black man, but at least Christianity will have an option. There will be an alternative for Christianity. So, and I'll be able to fully tell, look into God's eyes and tell him that I've been able to fulfill my own part, and I've carried out my own duty, and I've done my best, and that, you know, what he gave to me, that I was able to release everything, that I didn't just do 50% or 60% or 70%, that I was able to walk and release all what he has put in me, 100%, because the idea of death, the greatest death and the sweetest death, is the death that allows you to, is when you die empty, like my friend Miles Morrow used to say. That's the greatest form of death. What does that mean? That's talking about dying, being reassured that you've been able to release all the resources and the potentials that God put inside of you. So that's what I'm racing against. So my race is not against popularity, and my race is not against the audience or the views that I have, but my race is against myself. It's against the volume, the amount of stuff that is inside of me. So that is my own struggle. So I'm competing against myself. So I need all the time that is necessary that I need to be able, to really be able to pour out as much as possible. And the goal is to empty myself. And once I know that it's done, then I'll be ready to go to heaven. I'll be ready to go home. But to die with those things buried in the cemetery and taking them back to heaven will not be a benefit to the people that it was meant to be a blessing to.
I find it so interesting because looking at the comments, it's so funny. People are saying, no, don't stop, Pastor, don't even think of stopping. And it's it's really funny because one thing that if you've observed that, because I know that Pastor is not going to stop this because we've been discussing this before, and like he said, his primary purpose is to empty himself and to unleash everything God has told him. So whatever anybody's saying or suggesting or trying to do, he will just continue this course of emptying himself. And, you know, it doesn't matter if people are listening, catching up or not, because he's living beyond the here and now. It's not about just satisfying the people who are on the show right now, but it's about, you know, I mean, enriching people's lives, generations to come, 300 years to come. So don't worry, Pastor Sunday is going to continue, and even those who are going to watch this when we are all long gone, they're also going to be benefiting from it. So let me see the comments here. Some people are saying, are very vocal about this stopping or not stopping. Chris is saying, sir, please, oh, don't stop, oh. Blessing is saying, stop, okay? No way, I'm addicted. Henrietta is saying, please, oh, don't stop. She now says, saying, to stop what? No stopping of the life messages. Chris is saying, this is the reason, this is the season of truth, and the hammer must keep hitting the brick wall, hitting the brick wall until the wall comes crashing down. Nose Baker is saying, please, sir, do not stop. This is our assembly at the moment. You can take a break to rest and stream the old messages going. Chris is saying, well done, thou good and faithful servant is awaiting you, sir. May is saying, DSA, please don't stop. Bea is saying, please don't even think of stopping. Chris is saying, DSA, the impact you're making is beyond comprehension. You are digging at the very root of the kingdom of darkness. It is only a matter of time for the whole house to come crashing down. Yes. Okay. Okay. Chris is saying, even if it's twice or thrice a week, it is fine. This is now our church, the online church. Okay. Interesting. So, the next point in our letter is, I am beginning to ask myself questions about who I am, and the difference now is that I think I am having a glimpse of what I am here to do. I'm not fully sure yet, but I know as I dig deeper, I will discover myself more. So
that's a beautiful thing, because if you had been listening to me only for, since that was, he wrote this letter in January, and before then he had started listening to me just at the end of November. 2 months, and in 2 months it says is, and in 2 months you are limited in how many stuff you have listened to,
mm-hmm.
and it's saying he is now more interested in discovering his calling,
mm-hmm.
and living for purpose rather than just living for survival.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's where we all want to be. We all want to get to a place, and that's actually the purpose of what I'm doing. I want to do my best so that people will not live for Uncle Sam,
mm-hmm.
and people will not live for survival, and people will not just look for making a living, and people will not just try to just make it or survive in life, but that people will discover the essence and value of life. And will make up their mind that they want to just live like that, in accordance to the heavenly trajectory, that they want to follow heaven's vision, heaven's direction, and heaven's guidance for their life. So that's what he's talking about.
Mm-hmm.
And that is the essence of living. That is the essence of living. Beautiful.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he's also very honest. He's saying that I'm not fully sure yet, but I know as I dig deeper, I will discover myself more. So he understands that.
Yeah, he has not listened to, for example, the Calling series,
mm.
and probably has not read the book Who Am I yet.
Mm-hmm.
And so by the time, the good thing is that there are answers down there.
Mm.
So he doesn't really need to struggle.
Yeah.
He only needs to go and look for the Who Am I series.
Mm-hmm.
No, Calling the Purpose series,
yes.
on YouTube,
yeah.
and then go and look for the book, Who Am I, and Why Am I Here?
Mm-hmm.
Once he goes to listen, it's like, it doesn't fail. This kind of medicine that, my those messages are like medicines,
mm-hmm.
that sure banker, that definitely, you know, guarantee results. So if he goes to listen to the Purpose and Calling series, he will definitely discover who he is and why he's here.
Mm.
And especially if he reads on top of that the Who Am I book.
Mm.
And if he will be diligent enough to sit down and actually honestly answer all the questions in that book, that it's just nobody who has gone through that process and have not been able to lay their hands on who they are. And what they're meant to do. So everybody that have been able to go through that series, either on YouTube, of Who Am I, you know, Calling and Purpose series, or they have read the book, Who Am I? Everybody has been able to come back with a testimony that, yeah, it's actually easy to discover who you are. And that it's not such a big mystery after all.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, people are in churches like for 20 years, 30 years, from what I'm hearing and learning right now from people's stories and testimonies. I discovered that people could go to church for 10, 20, 30 years and not actually be able to lay their hands on their purpose and calling. But here, you just need 1 month. And, you know, because the material is already there. And the way the book is written, Who Am I? It's written in such a way that it's like holding you by the hand and just leading you right into your purpose. Because it's putting you in a very streamlined road to your purpose, asking you questions, helping you to look into yourself, giving you ideas, suggestions on how to do it, and very, very practical and very direct way of discovering who you are and what you are called for. And that is the same thing with the teachings. Some people don't even get to listen to all the teaching, the series on Who Am I and Purpose and Calling. They just need to do half of it or 50%, and they've already discovered who they are.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, so guys, if you are also someone like that who's thinking, I'm not really sure yet who I am and how I should go about this because I have to do this, I know that there's something in me, I know that I'm called for something specific, and I have a specific identity, you can do that by going to Sunday Adelaja Official on YouTube and look for the Calling series, Calling and Purpose series, and go through it. It's actually not even that long, and it's very compact, and after that, I will recommend to you to get the book, Who Am I? Why Am I Here? And this will really round up the whole experience of you discovering who you are. And it's not going to be ending there, really. You're going to just be motivated so much based on that discovery. It will go further and discover even more about yourself, or what you're supposed to do, what you can do, what you're capable of doing. So go and get these resources, and it's going to help you. You're not going to regret it. So the next point he's mentioning is, I live in Canada, and I'm beginning to ask myself how I can help my community and show them the love of God. I have some ideas, but not sure how to execute them yet. I'm not scared because I know it will come to me as I meditate and prepare. It looks like he has understood the secret of solitude here. No? Because he's saying that the ideas and the way on how to go about knowing exactly what to do for his community is going to come as he meditates and prepares. Because many people will be saying, oh, yeah, I just have to put out a plan and just try to work by that plan. To me, this looks a lot like solitude. I don't know what you think.
Well, I think it's still connected to discovering the fact that he's not here just for nothing. I think purposeful living and effective living. And I don't know if we are going to, where are those books there? There are two specific books. I'm not sure if they're actually three books that I would have liked to highlight talking about this topic. And those books are The Essence and Value of Life. I think that's what this gentleman had started realizing or discovering. He started to discover the essence and value of life. And as a result, he's no more interested in just living a mundane, trivial life anymore. So even though he's in Canada, and you might think that in Canada there is no need to struggle, but he already wants to contribute. He wants to contribute. So there are three books. So that is The Essence and Value of Life, How to Live an Effective Life, How to Get What You Need in Life. Yeah, so those are the books that I'm talking about. So this is one of the books, How to Live an Effective Life. So you could just tell in the tone of this guy's letter that he's just caught it. He got it. He got the secret of living an effective life. He's awakened to the reality of living an effective life. is all of a sudden his spirit has been aroused to the fact that living just for living's sake is not worth it anymore. It's no more worth it just trying to survive and making a living. It's no more worth it just trying to, you know, barely get by. Now he wants to concretely, you know, begin to live an effective life. So that is this one, this book here. How to live an effective life. How to live an effective life. Somebody wrote me, an American lady, who doesn't even follow me on Facebook. I think the person just ran into the book, and the person just said, this is one of the greatest books she's ever read in her whole life. But apart from this book, there is another book, How to Get What You Need in Life. So that is also talking about living for something, living for something. Then there is another one, which explains to us the whole essence of life itself, the essence and value of life. So some of those things, he had ordered 10 of my books or so. You know, he's read 3 or so of them. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, this is another one. This is another book that might be in that line, but this is a very, very unique one. A visionless life is a meaningless life. So the guy started, even maybe without even reading the book, he started to live a concentrated, and a vision-driven life. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I'm just happy that at least right now there is an option for people. There is an alternative for people. There is at least an answer. They know where to get the answers. And life is no more like in the cloud somewhere, or just trying to grope in the dark and trying to get along. Because the greatest problem of life is that the whole world has been programmed. When a child is born, you know exactly what it says, what's expected of it. Go to the kindergarten, go to primary school, secondary school, university, go to job. So that has been mapped out for him, that nothing else could be out of that box. So a child is just put in a box, and you cannot come out of that box. Whereas the God of heaven who created him didn't put him in a box. But even the nature of the child and every one of us resists and rebels and tries to rebel against the conditioning of our environment. Our nature, why do we? All of us have been rebellious one time or the other in our lives. Most people have been rebellious. And the reason they have been rebellious is because they know that their body, their whole life, their whole essence is crying for something else. They want to do something else. They want to discover life in their own unique way. They want to remain unique. But we talk about discipline, we talk about compiling, compliance. And we bring compliance to these children, and by the time they are adults, they are also complying, forcing their own children to comply. Mm. So this whole world is about conditioning.
Yeah.
The school system, it's all the same all over the world. Yeah. Conditioning.
Conditioning to the good or the bad.
To be used, the conditioning mainly for your youth to be good enough to go to work. Mm. Conditioning, everything that the whole conditioning is about you not questioning, not rebelling, being obedient, and to just go and service the system.
Mm.
You have been conditioned not to question, not to rebel, not to fight the system.
Mm-hmm.
Go and get a job, marry, be given birth to children, when you give birth to one, oh, stay home for 3 months or 6 months, take some rest, go back to work. Mm-hmm. And if you want to rebel against, if you don't want to go to back to work, poverty will help you. Mm-hmm. Hunger will help you. And then everything is put out there so that you want the lust. They use advertisement and everything to make you lust after things. So that you know, you want to compete with your neighbor as well. So that is all conditioning. Mm-hmm. So that you will just be working to keep the system running. But you are nobody. You are not needed. You are nothing. You are not needed. You only needed to feed. It's just like cow. If you've been in the Western world, if you see the way poultry and husbandry works, farm, the animal farm, mm-hmm. like, the cows, you keep them there, just feed them, and the reason why you're feeding them is not because you love that cow.
No, definitely not.
You are feeding that cow
for yourself.
Because you need the milk to grow big,
mm-hmm.
the breast to grow big, and to be, you, because you want to get that milk from it.
Mm-hmm.
And then when you are tired of the milk and they don't give you the milk, you know, you will kill that cow and eat the fish,
mm-hmm.
and the meat. Mm-hmm. So you are not feeding him for him.
Mm-hmm.
So that is how human beings, that's how they treat human beings. So before, in the olden days, the cows used to roam in the reservations and in the
farms, like fields.
Yeah, in the fields and in the desert.
Mm-hmm.
And they are free, they live their life. But now, they put them in a poultry.
Mm-hmm.
So that they could, that's what the world has done for human beings.
Mm-hmm.
Human beings also, the whole society of the Western society is like that poultry too.
Mm-hmm.
So,
and it's not necessarily bad that the poultry exists, right? So they're doing it with animals. But the problem is that they're doing it with human beings.
Yeah, you know what they're doing with animals, we are made to become lords of the animals.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, because human beings are the lords of the animals.
Yeah.
But what I'm talking about is that what they have done, because they always start everything with experimentation with the animals.
Mm-hmm.
So what they have done, succeeded in doing with animals, they are now doing with humans.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, for example, if you go to Africa, you can still see animals walking about freely,
yeah.
and running about, because the system has not been perfected. It has not been modularized on Africa. So you can still see some. That's why you have issues like henchmen.
Mm.
Because they have not been tamed yet. They've not been pulled out yet.
Mm.
And conditioned totally yet,
mm-hmm.
in Africa.
Mm-hmm.
So, so there they can see, you can see have free animals walking around. But in Europe, you will never see things like that. They have all been put in poultry. But now in Europe, it has gone beyond animals being put in poultry. Now, human beings, the whole society is built like that poultry, like the animal farm. So the cities, every society, that's why everybody, just like the cows must be registered and have their number. That's how everybody in the West is registered.
Mm-hmm.
You are registered, don't like the cow.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then you must go to work. And you must go. So the whole educational system, from beginning to till you die, everything is mapped out for you. You are caged. You are not free. You are not a human being anymore. You've lost it. Now, what makes that bad is because human beings are not supposed to be caged like that. Human beings are not supposed to be locked down in a poultry. Human beings are not supposed to, other human beings are not supposed to cage other human beings. Other human beings are not supposed to, you know, put you in a farm and in a reserve, games reserve, and make you function from morning to night. And you'll just give you some, a little bit of entertainment. You know, in the poultry also with the animals, they also go there and entertain them. The same thing they do to humans now. They give you a car, a new car is out. Then you are running after the car like a mirage.
Mm.
So that you walk more to get another car that will come next year. The same cow, but they will just change maybe the shape of the light and then the bit of the nose, the sharper. And then you are running like you are deaf, like you are deaf and blind. You are just like you are foolish, like you don't know it's the same. So, but the society has been have succeeded in making human beings just to duplicate those animals and be the same thing. So, but the more you can put them under a condition, the better for it is for society. Everybody lives in peace. They don't like troublemakers. Just like you don't like troublemakers in your, some of those, your cow also. You don't like, you like all of them to fall.
It actually makes me, it makes me think about the school system, the education system, because it starts there. The brainwash starts there. And not just because of the way the education system is constructed, but also the things they teach you when it comes to science and biology. Because they will tell you about Darwin's theories and his discoveries, and then they will try to make you, convince you of the fact that you are also just an animal. And because of that, you are, it's your life is predictable, and the way you're supposed to be nourished with information, with food, and all these things is predictable. So they came up with the pyramids of Maslow, for example, and then all these different things where you're taught in school that you are just a product of nature somehow, just like every other animal.
Just like a plant.
Yes, just like a plant, just a little bit more evolved. And therefore, you need exactly the same thing as a normal animal who may be...
No, like the chicken.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you believe it. You're saying, yeah, yeah, of course. We're just animals. Nobody told you that you're...
Because you've been conditioned not to question anything, not to query.
Wow. I'm sure people know that in school, or at least those who run it, and they just don't want to tell you. Because we are all creative.
No,
okay,
no,
all
people
the...
who run it... Only very, maybe 1% of people know what I'm telling you now.
Yeah.
Maximum 3% of the old people. Everybody wants to get a job because they want to survive. Just like the animal. When you put food like this, everybody is fighting for it. The same thing with human beings.
Yeah.
They want to fight. I want to get the bigger piece. I want to get the bigger piece. Oh, no, I got this one, you didn't get it.
Huh.
So, I have a book I wrote about that. And nobody knows about this book. That, well, what I'm telling you right now, I have a book on it.
In Russian?
No, in English.
Which one?
It's called I'm a Person. Am I a Personality?
Mm-hmm.
All the persons are the ones in the farm.
The biomasses.
The biomasses, yes. That's where you have my picture. I think I should have it somewhere in that. The book should be somewhere there.
Yeah.
I'm a Person. Am I a Personality? So that's talking about, you know, what I'm saying right now, that then in that book, I've written the system of conditioning and how you are conditioned and how you are made to comply, how the whole world system has, is set up in a way to make you not to fall out of, not to come out of the camp. This is the book here.
Mm-hmm.
I am the person. Am I a personality? The only people who get to know the difference are the personalities. All other people, they are just individuals who are in the farm. And it starts with your parents. Your parents don't even know that they are helping you to become a biomass.
Hmm.
Yeah.
I read sometime that the person, I read through comments through a video. I don't remember the video anymore, but I remember the comment that the person was saying, but what if someone is called to just be mediocre? And to not have, like, so much impact, and to just have, like, a small house of wood somewhere in the wilderness, or, I don't know, on hills somewhere, and then, I don't know, cultivate the land. Maybe they're called to do this. Is everyone called
that's
to
why,
make
a... That's why some people, that's why the society gives those kind of people the freedom to be homeless. The mediocres, they are homeless. Because they cannot cope up with the race of the society.
So if they are mediocres, who are then those who do cope up with the race?
Those are, everybody is mediocre that
yeah.
is coping with the race. But you are probably talking about the ones that just don't want to be in the system.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. So that's why I'm talking about the homeless people.
Okay.
Every other person is mediocre.
Okay. So you would say that nobody's called to be mediocre, like to just have
God
this simple
yeah,
life.
God doesn't make everybody, God doesn't call anybody to come to this world to just applaud the success of another person.
Mm-hmm.
So why would God just create you to be the one that is applauded, the cheerleader of your mates, of your classmates.
Mm. And by applauding, you're saying just using what is being prepared for you?
No. Just following them, what they are doing, and then, you know, telling them, oh, yeah, all of you are good, you are doing a good job, mm. where you are just, you are not, nothing is credited to you.
Okay. Interesting.
Everybody is actually, by God, the way God planned it, is that everybody is empowered with something. Everybody is gifted with something, equally. Different conditions will happen that make people to reach, to come to any conclusion.
Mm-hmm.
But God himself, from God's perspective, God wants everybody to relate to each other equally, because everybody is equally gifted. So everybody has, everybody's gift creates a leverage for them.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And not just one gift somebody has, but as many gifts as possible, for him to be able to create leverages for himself.
Mm.
But the only thing is that when the society is being turned into a farm,
mm-hmm.
or into a poultry, like I said, human poultry, the problem is that in the poultry, you need to always struggle. So in the poultry now, you are not existing like the flowers that are just blossoming and, you know, bringing forth scent and color and, you know, flower and on their own. But in the human poultry that we call society, the problem there is that it is artificially driven. So you are being conditioned to live by what it has already been created.
Mm-hmm.
And if you don't follow, then you'll be left out. And then the society is always putting pressure on you to comply. You have to marry. You've got to give back to people. Why?
Mm.
You don't have a choice. They make you, yeah, because you are not human anymore.
Mm.
They reduce you. They remove humanity from you.
Mm.
I'm a person, my personality. They kill your personality.
Yeah.
You are a woman, so you must have children.
Even in Germany, this is propagated. If I look at the German system, for example, and the tax system, you have more benefits of the tax system in Germany if you are in a family or in a relationship. Not if you're single and living by yourself. Then you have to pay more taxes. You have to work harder because it looks like you have more energy to give the system, and you know, can sacrifice more. But if you're in a family, then you can breed more of yourself. And therefore you need more space, just a little bit more.
But they're encouraging you to breed more of slaves.
Yeah.
You are thinking you are breeding more of yourself because
yeah.
it's going to bring out your name, it's your own child. But that's not what not the society is thinking.
Mm-hmm.
The system is thinking that if the person is going to give, if it's a girl, is going to give birth to more people. All of them are going to work. They are going to work for the system. They are
mm-hmm.
going to keep the economy going.
Mm-hmm.
It's all about economy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's all about economy. That's so true. Wow.
It's about the factory.
Mm-hmm. So he has definitely understood that.
So if anybody wants to really control this life, this book is as powerful as the book of Stop Working for Uncle Sam. This might even be more powerful because it makes you to take control. Stop Working for Uncle Sam makes you to take control of your life economically. But this one makes you to take control of your life individually, personality.
Mentally, so.
Mentally, socially, individually.
Mm.
You take your decision and you know the reason why this how society works.
Mm. Wow. Get the books, people. Get the book and I want to try to get it as well. I mean, to read it, because I read your Uncle Sam, but I think...
But you are able to take your decision.
Yeah, I was.
That's the economic one, but this one is...
Yes.
A little bit different, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So,
for example, nobody will tell you that because you are a girl, then you have to marry.
Mm.
Nobody will condition you to just reason like that, you will actually be seeing them as strange now.
Mm-hmm.
Or nobody will tell you you have to have some children. Why? Okay, for example, sometimes you show the video of women who are getting testimony, who waited for 10 years, 3 years, who didn't have children, now I have 3 children.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm asking why? Why do you have those children? What for?
Yeah.
Oh, just for, because it's my name, it's going to carry my name. Okay. Tell me, you yourself that is saying somebody should carry your name. Tell me who was your grand-grandfather, grand-grandparents, 6 generations ago, 5 generations ago, 4 generations ago. You don't even care.
Mm-hmm.
And do you know that even you yourself, you have your name has been changed so many times that you will not even recognize. Maybe the name you are bearing now, Adelaja,
yeah.
Maybe it's a Yoruba name, but maybe originally you are actually from Saudi Arabia somewhere,
mm-hmm.
or Sudan.
Mm-hmm.
And now you are saying you are in Nigeria. Who said? It's a bunch of illusion.
Yeah.
It's a bunch of illusion.
Especially for us Africans, since we don't have a lot of, like, there's just so much that has gotten lost in our history as well, that we are not being taught in schools and everything. So it shows also that it's not even that important.
No, even if you are being taught, even if you know it, even if you are being taught in school. Let's say, for example, I have children, let's say 10 children, and all of them are successful in the next 100 generations. What will I know about that? I will not even be aware of it. I will be dead. So, what was the benefit of it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And most of the time when I'm still alive, most of the time I'm just working for them to make it. Then I die. Or when they are grown up, to help me, I'm too weak, I'm too old to even notice anything.
Mm-hmm.
Life is all that is. So we shouldn't look for that. What life is really about is about me discovering his plan, why he allowed me to come here, and live in such a way that I will be able to continue the life that I started here, be able to receive the reward over there. So the life that I'm living here should be a sowing time. So I'm sowing not to reap here on earth, but to reap where I'm going. Because over there, I will be there not for 100 years like here, but I will be there for eternity. So everything I want to do right now should be focusing, not to be distracted by some children or wife or something, but, you know, from filling up the treasure over there. But I should have more time, the most time possible, to gather as much treasure in heaven, because that's my ultimate goal, that's my ultimate destination.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not what I do here for myself that really matters, therefore. It's what I do for heaven that really matters, because that's where I'm going. But because when I just live here for myself, for my children, for my own family, then I get to heaven and I discover that there are no children there, and there are no family there, no
mm-hmm.
husband, no wife. It doesn't make any sense.
Mm-hmm. Well, one has to get to that reasoning in the first place. And I think our writer here, at least, he is in a good place to even go into saying that he understands he has to first of all discover himself, even if he hasn't gotten there yet. So yeah, well done, writer. The next point is, I have always been a very frugal person, not carrying money and enjoying see the money I save grow. But the angle I am still working on is
not carrying money or not caring for money.
Not carrying it. And enjoying seeing it growing as he saved. But the angle I'm still working on is how to make the money grow through investments and entrepreneurship. I hope through you, I can join some investment groups and be in the know of opportunities as they arise. I've linked up with people that you interviewed, like Benita Awobi, Nadine Bazia, and Dennis Etsebuzi.
Yeah, Yeah, investment, yeah. That's, you know, but again, we have to also think, what is the purpose of the investment? Investment is not a big deal. I can help anybody to make a billion, to invest, multiply their money or anything like that. But I have come to discover that a lot of people who want to save their money or multiply their money, they are just thinking of a bigger car or a house outside of the city or, you know, something like that, or a bigger house. But I'm not interested in that. If you want to multiply your money just to buy a bigger house or a bigger car, you know, then don't come to me. But if you want to multiply your money to set you free, the reason why I want to help people multiply their money is this. I want to set them free.
Yeah, yeah, I think that's what he said.
From Uncle Sam.
Mm-hmm.
So that they will have the money working for them.
Mm-hmm.
While they work for God.
Yeah.
That's what I'm interested in. I want to be able to help people take their money, give them back some percentages, maybe yearly, so that they can live on that. For example, I'm going to Africa now. A lot of people will never be able to go to Africa because they don't have anything working for them. They are tied to the Uncle Sam system. So even though their heart might be to go and build a better Africa, but they cannot because they have to pay for the school fees of their children, they have to pay for the rent, they have to pay for the this and that. So that's why you need savings.
Mm-hmm.
The savings will enable you to have something to multiply.
Yeah.
So what I can do for people is just to help them with the multiplication aspect of things. Not just this, but they have to do the saving aspect. But if you just want to multiply, just to, you know, get some things, just to enjoy life, forget about that.
Yeah, I think that's really important to distinguish here, because in churches even those who you think are advanced, they will say that as a Christian, you can be poor, you have to be rich so you can influence other people. But it's not like they are even thinking about being free, not even thinking about the money, and making sure that this money only enables them to understand what God is wanting, wants from them.
Yeah.
But this is not even taught. It's more like you have to be a rich Christian so that you can be...
You can show off.
Yeah, you can show that God is faithful and God, you know, is not a poor God. God.
That is childish. That's what children do.
Yeah.
You know when little kids say, "Oh, my father is more rich than your father."
Yeah.
I mean, look at this stupidity. Oh, I mean, like you're a teenager. You're not even a teenager. It's like you're younger than teenagers, like the school kids,
mm-hmm.
elementary school children. But you see. My daddy just bought it. It's because I belong to this family.
Mm-hmm.
That's why I have it. Rubbish.
Mm-hmm.
Everything God gives you is for you to be able to expand the kingdom.
Yeah.
And do the greatest good, the greater number of good to a greater number of people.
Mm. And I think you've talked about this in your financial series as well. No? In the laws of money, laws and principles of money. So I can see someone is asking here, saying, DSA, please teach me how to invest. My goal is to be as financially independent so I can help others. Yeah, I would recommend them to read the books and also...
what are the books we have?
Yeah, we have several books. We have a book that is called Where There's Money, There's Problem. No, Where There's Problem, There's Money.
No, you look for the books. Let me explain the process.
Okay,
Now, the way to do it is this. I don't teach you on just how to invest. Teaching is easy. I've already taught. If you don't know that I've already taught how to, not how to invest, but how to deal with money, the loss of money, I've already done that. If you go to my YouTube page, you go there and look at the teachings I have. You will see that one of the teachings is called the loss of money or financial teachings. Financial teachings. So all the principles of money are there. But, you know, the problem that most people always come across is, okay, I have money now, or I've been able to save some money. Where do I invest? How am I sure of where to invest? That is where I come in, where I will help people. But then, I don't want to help anybody who has not listened to some of the teachings or read the financial books. If you have not read the books and you have not listened to the financial teachings, it doesn't make any sense for me to help you because you are going to blow it. You are still going to be living by the old rules. you are not going to abide by the rules of the money, by the laws of money. So first of all, people that I help to multiply their money will be somebody who has already followed the laws of money, who is already listening at least to the teachings and knows how to change his lifestyle and, you know, live according to that, the laws of money. Secondly, I can only help somebody who has at least been able to, you know, control his own appetite and been able to control himself and has been able to have some savings at least. So it is when you have some savings, now that savings could be multiplied. So the area I've done, there are two areas where I help. I wrote the books, I have the audio and video teachings, then I could help you if you have, you know, a good amount of savings or you've been able to control yourself with savings, then I could help you maybe with, you know, where to invest or how to invest to multiply. But the books, you know, one of the books is Where There Is Problem, There Is Money. It's a good financial book. Another one is Problems, Your Shortcut to Prominence. This is the most popular one of them all. It's called Money Won't Make You Rich. That is a mentality of mindset. Mm. You should have one there, mindset. Oh. How to Build a Secured Financial Future is another book here. How to Build a Secured Financial Future. Stop Working for Uncle Sam. And where is it? And Poverty Mindset versus Abundance Mindset. Now, some of you might be, yeah, maybe this one will be good too. Why losing your job is the best thing that could happen to you. But maybe you might be thinking, so what order should you use? Where, how should you start? I think you should start with the audio, with the video, books, the Laws of Money, financial teachings on YouTube. And as well, be reading this one parallel. This is the number one, the most important one for you to read. One, then you might want to read this, number two, Poverty Mindset versus Abundance Mindset. Yeah, so these are the two. Start with Money Won't Make You Rich, Poverty Mindset versus Abundance Mindset. Then from there, go to this one, How to Build a Secured Financial Future. So those three books will be the ones you want to start with. So after you finish these three books, then you might want to begin to read Stop Working for Uncle Sam, Where There Is Problem, There Is Money, Problems, Your Shortcut to Preeminence, and then maybe this one, Why Losing Your Job is the Best Thing That Could Happen to You. So those are the financial series, but at least start doing something. Start changing your mind. Start working on your brain, on your mind, on your mindset. So that's where everything starts from. Everything starts from your mind. So if you could begin to do that, and you have to have some results, you have to be able to, because savings, why savings is important is because it helps you to limit your appetite. It helps you to cut your coat according to your size, and it helps you to prove that you are abiding by the first two laws of money. The first law of money is never meant to be spent. The second law of money is retention. You know, you must retain money. You must you must be able to retain money. You have to have victory over dictates of money. So those two laws of money, once you have the victory over them, then you have savings. The proof that you are obeying the laws of money is that you have savings. Now, the next level is investment, and that's where I could help you.
Interesting. And you also have the book, Don't Eat Tomorrow's Food Today, right?
Yeah, it should be somewhere here.
Yeah, I couldn't.
Don't Eat Tomorrow's Food
Today.
Yeah, it's a green book with the dollar in the plate.
Mm.
Yeah, but don't worry about it. I think you should.
Nah.
What are they writing?
Yeah, let me check what they're writing. So, Chioma has put her number here. So, if you need any books of Dr. Sunday
in Nigeria,
you can contact her. Chioma Ugudinwibe, that's her name. And she put up her number. You can contact her, call her, or send her a WhatsApp message. And Chris Allen saying, new wine must be placed in a new wineskin. And he also said, the bottom line of getting money and becoming independent is to fulfill purpose. That is a thread in all of DSA's books. Jika is saying, DSA, okay. I hope we fix that now, the volume, Chika. Caroline is saying, everything God gives us is to expand the kingdom. True. Caroline is also saying, everything God gives, okay, that's a duplicate. Chope is saying, DSA, please teach me. Okay, sorry, I have read that already.
One who said I should teach them on investment.
Yeah.
I've already explained the steps.
Mm-hmm.
If any question, let them just write them.
Yeah. Okay. So any questions after you follow the steps, you can write Dr. Sunday at pastor@godembassy.org. So I guess you have gotten pretty interesting and very practical steps to follow there. And I'm sure they will keep you busy for a longer time, which is good. You have to build a very strong foundation. Okay, what else do we have here? Chris Al is saying, so true, 3 to 4 generations from now, no one will remember you if you don't discover and fulfill your purpose, if you don't do any exploit for the kingdom. Chris is also saying the instruction was, be fruitful, multiply, replenish, and subdue. And it was an instruction for all men. Things are so bad that we now believe that everybody cannot be rich. Everyone has the potential to fulfill their purpose. But unfortunately, not all will because of the kind of information they have received all their lives. Truth is very scarce. And he also says, very true. Christian, you're very active. Thank you for all your comments. Very true. The whole society has been put in a cage and has been conditioned like robots, and the programmers update software code once in a while to control the robots the way they want. It's very true.
Who is
yeah.
writing that?
Chris.
Wow.
Yeah. It's very, very true. Okay, Helen is saying, God and Christianity is not complicated as we were taught. Thanks, DSA, for simplifying Christianity. No more deliverance. Okay. Helen also says, yeah, I have become a better person since I started listening to DSA. Ifeinia says, me too, my life has changed. Chris Al is saying, your messages are directly from the throne of God. No one who diligently goes through your series of books will not be transformed. If we can just take the time and dedication to follow the instructions, it is completely impossible not to be a changed person. Your books require solitude. That would be also interesting.
Solitude, that is to go and read them in solitude or meditate on them?
Go and read them in solitude, because you have to meditate on them. So it includes both of it, I think. Okay, Tope saying, amen, this is my church too. Gift is saying, what sense does it make going to a church whereby the leaders cannot help you to build your dreams into reality? Miriam is saying, my nickname is Online Church. Toyin is also saying, this platform has become church for me. Okay. Joy is saying, the only reason I would advise stopping is when you are in Nigeria, so busy, because I know it will be a landslide.
Yeah, Nigeria.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Tracy is saying, very true, plus we love your swag. Matthias is saying, the content will outlast...
What is swag?
Your swag. How can you describe swag?
I guess your swag. They like my charisma?
Yeah.
Or personality?
Yeah. Everything, like you, the way you dress, the way you talk, that's the swag. Matthias is saying, the content will outlast this generation. Chris is saying, okay, I read that already about the church. Okay. May is saying, poverty mindset versus abundant mindset is a very good one. I just finished reading. My brain has been working like a clock. I'm one person that likes to spend like there's no tomorrow.
Who is that?
That's May. May saying that. After reading
this book.
Yeah. After reading this book, a couple of weeks ago, trust me, I'm not the same. Matthias is saying, what is the best way to learn from DSA? Videos versus books.
Okay, you want me to answer that?
Mm-hmm.
Well, the best way to learn from me, it depends on what you prefer. If you are audio person or visual person, you might want to go, if you are an audio person, you might want to go to SoundCloud and be listening in your car or something like that. Well, if you are a video person, you might want to go to YouTube. But the best way for me to deliver, the best way that I deliver is in writing.
Hmm. Interesting. Okay.
I'm not a speaking person. I mean, I can speak, but that is not my, because when I'm speaking, I don't have time to think for too long. I'm mm-hmm. just thinking very fast.
Mm-hmm.
And when I'm speaking, I don't have time to refine my thoughts
mm-hmm.
as well.
Mm-hmm.
So, but when I'm writing, I can think, I can do research, mm-hmm. I can refine my thoughts, I can go back, correct, add to it, you know,
mm-hmm.
I can perfect my ideas.
Yeah, yeah.
So the best materials of Pastor Sunday that you might want to have are my books.
Mm-hmm. Oh. That makes a lot of sense, yeah, absolutely.
But initially, you wanted to say you didn't notice, difference or something.
No, I was going to say, I would have said the best way to learn from you is when you teach.
Is when I teach?
Yeah.
That's because it intrigues you, because you like it.
No, I was thinking about the HMTs, actually, and that these were the moments for me, the crucial moments for me, where I thought, wow, okay, and I saw results. Before even I started reading your books, even though one of your books, for example, make me take a very drastic decision in my life, like coming here, but even listening to your teachings alone changed my mindset and being here during the HMT before you started all the broadcasts. So for me, an HMT may be an intense teaching, like an HMT, not just the 9 p.m. broadcast, but the thorough bootcamp kind of environment.
When I'm having enough time to to actually come out with everything in a concentrated fashion.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, the next person is saying, DSA, just because of your teaching, I'm cleaning my house before my wife gets home.
That's another one.
Yeah.
Let them write for the program. Maybe we'll be able to use their letters.
Yeah, you can write
them. Or we could invite them for Kingdom Fruits.
Yes.
Maybe you'll announce that.
Yeah.
Book reviews too.
Yeah, just like May, for example, you said you read the book Poverty Mindset, Abundance Mindset. You can write us at VIP@godembassy.org and we'll give you all the details if you want to share what you learned and the lessons and recommendations. Do a book review of the book that you read. And the same goes for Plutonic. If you want to share your testimony, please write us as well, VIP@godembassy.org, so that we can either read out your letter or even better, or as you prefer, really, do the Kingdom Fruits with you. And then
this is a live broadcast.
Sorry?
They could actually go and link their on Amazon as well.
Yes. If you read a book, very important, if you read a book of Dr. Sunday and you bought your book on Amazon, actually even if you didn't, but you read the book, even if you didn't buy it through Amazon, you can go and leave a review. This would really help people. It will help many people to take the right decisions on reading the books. And we want more people to read the books. And many people rely on those reviews and taking the right decision or taking the decision to buy or not to buy the books. So try to, please, if you have read a book, leave a review on Amazon and help us to get the word out, please. Rebecca is saying, hello, headed to Ukraine soon to adopt. God bless ya.
What?
Headed to Ukraine soon to adopt. I guess she wants to
come to Ukraine soon.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think we should tell people when it's the nice visit to Ukraine.
Yes.
To everybody.
Yeah, so you can all come and join us here in Ukraine for the next HMT. We will start with the church anniversary on March 29th, and then we will continue on the 2nd of April with the History of Baker Street.
Yeah, from March 29th to the 8th of April.
Yeah. So from March 29th to the 7th of
to the 8th
of April, and this is where people have the church anniversary and History Makers training. So register now. You can do that on sundayatthelarjablog.com/visit. and register your place here so that you can participate. You really don't want to miss this. Be here for all you can do doing this for this year. Anything, any major thing that you have planned for the year, any travel, I recommend you to travel to Ukraine for this program.
What about the mentorship? Maybe some people have not joined yet.
Yeah. Okay, so mentorship program, you can also join. We have a second class that we recently opened. So you can do that by also going to sundayatelijahblog.com/mentorship and register there. Try to do that as soon as possible because we have the registration form open until the end of February. So if you haven't registered yet, register now. If you have a question, you can send it after you have registered and you haven't received anything, for example. Message us at mentorship@godinvestee.org so that we help you out. Okay. So, all right. Thank you for answering my question. Matthias says, it has been a struggle since DSA materials are all good and it's always tough to form a pattern. Okay. Okay, great. So we are coming at the, we've come to the end of our program.
Is it?
Yes.
You're it's too ready? Short today.
It is short. Well, it's the normal, usual time.
O'clock?
Yeah, past 8 o'clock already. Yes, so already 20 past 8.
Oh.
So we have to get ready for the next program. And thank you very much, everyone, for joining us.
We're ready for the next program.
Yes. So thank you all for joining. I'll see you, well, we will see you, Sally will see you doing the program at 9 p.m. Ukraine time, 7 p.m. UK time. Join us for today's message.
In 40 minutes.
So we'll be back soon. Thank you.
Maybe I should say bye to them too.
I'll say bye now.
You can see that the girls are tired, huh? The girls are tired. The girls are ready to go to bed. They're ready to take a switch off. All right, we'll see you in 20 minutes. 40 minutes.